over there, over there. Send the word over there. There's the anchor coming, the anchor coming, the drum, drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there.
I have to say, before I go any further, it's an honor to be here, and I'm thrilled to be in a room with so many people who know much more about World War I than I do. I was listening, I was eavesdropping on snatches of conversation over lunch here and there, and most of it was totally over my head. So thank you all very much for that. I'm used to being the guy in the room who knows the most about World War I, and I'm really thrilled to be around people who know so much more about it than I do. This book happened by accident. People often ask me, why did you write this book? And it wasn't supposed to be a book. Originally, I was supposed to be working on a different book after my last book, a book about genealogy. And I was doing something that writers do very well. I was procrastinating. And this was early in 2003. And I was living in Manhattan at the time, and I was listening to WNYC, the public radio station in New York. And the guest that day was talking about World War II and the World War II generation. And he said that they were dying at that point at the rate of 1,000 World War II veterans every day. And his voice took on a tone of great urgency. And he said, we need to get their stories now while we still can. And that made a very strong impression on me, too. But for some reason that day, I had a contrary thought. I thought, you know, I've met lots of World War II veterans. There were actually a few who were living at that time in the small apartment building I lived in on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. And I'd heard a lot of World War II stories, but I couldn't remember the last time I'd met a World War I veteran or heard a World War I story. And I wondered if it were still possible to go out and get these stories. I did the math in my head. Like I said, it was 2003, so 85 years after the armistice. I figured somebody who was 20 in 1918 would be 105 in 2003, which was a little daunting. But I'm one of those strange people who reads the obituaries first thing in the paper every morning. I find them fascinating. You ever wish that papers would run people's obituaries while they were still living? All the time. So I knew from these obituaries that people did occasionally live to be 105, sometimes even a bit older. So I thought, I'll go out and I'll find two or three, interview them, write up a magazine article for Memorial Day or maybe Veterans Day if it takes a bit longer, and then get back to this book on genealogy. And that's exactly what would have happened if I could have found two or three living American World War I veterans. But I couldn't. My first call was to the Department of Veterans Affairs in Washington, D.C. I assumed in my naivete that they would have a spreadsheet of all of America's living World War I veterans with their names, addresses, phone numbers, emergency contacts, and that they would eagerly share this information with me. And I was told very quickly that they had no such database, no such spreadsheet, and that even if they had, they couldn't share it with me because of privacy laws. And for years, I thought that they were really just putting me off. And then, around 3 years later or so, I started getting calls from people at the VA asking me how many living American veterans of World War I there still were and where they might be. So I came to understand that, in fact, they never did have such a list in the first place, which kind of mystifies me, but it's undeniable. So I went on, I started to call VA hospitals, nursing homes, VFW posts, American Legion posts, anybody I could think of, asking them if they knew of any living American veterans of World War I. And the answer was always the same. We haven't seen any 10, 15, 20 years. Let us know if you find any. This went on for about 2 or 3 months, and I started to get very frustrated. And then one day I made a discovery that probably a lot of people in this room already knew about at that point. I learned that in 1998, the government of France created a program wherein they would award this beautiful medal. This is the Legion of Honor, the highest award France gives. And according to this program, again, established in 1998, so 80 years after the end of the war, they would award this to any American veteran who could prove that they had served on French soil during World War I. And I should say that along with this medal, there's a very large, about this big, very large and impressive certificate. And this wasn't just PR. The French really wanted to give this thing out. And so they undertook an intensive search in 1998-1999 to locate and screen living American veterans who had served on French soil during World War I. They ran ads in newspapers and magazines around the country. They enlisted the VFW and the American Legion. And in the first year and a half or so of the program, 1998-1999, they ended up giving out about 550 Legions of Honor to American men and women who had served on French soil in World War I. And if you passed muster, and there were certain qualifications, the one I remember best is that you couldn't have a criminal record. But if you passed muster, they wouldn't just put this in the mail to you. This is a very big deal to France. They would actually dispatch an emissary from the French embassy in Washington, D.C. to your home or your hometown and put on a little ceremony and give you this wonderful medal and this impressive certificate and the thanks of the grateful nation of France. And they kept very good records. And so when I discovered the existence of this program, I called up the French embassy in Washington, D.C. and I asked them if it were possible, could they maybe pass my contact information on to two or three veterans who had gotten this award who might still be living? Remember, this was 5 years after they had given most of these out. And the men and women who had gotten them had already been in their late 90s, at least, when this had happened. I was passed on to a gentleman there, and this was the first very lucky break I got in this process. A gentleman named Nam Do Co, an adjutant at the French embassy. He was half French, half Vietnamese. And he was scheduled to be rotated back to Paris in about 3 weeks. And when I explained to him what I was trying to do, he was so moved by this that in his own free time, he photocopied all 550 or so successful applications for the Legion of Honor and FedExed them to me. And he would not take a dime for it. And I should point out that this was in the spring of 2003, which you may recall was not a particularly good time for Franco-American relations. In fact, Congress had just voted to change the name of French fries to Freedom Fries in their commissary. And yet I got my first big break in tracking down living American veterans of World War I from the government of France, and I can tell you without hesitation that this book would not exist without their help. Eventually I found about two dozen of the three dozen or so men and women I interviewed for this book off what I came to think of as the French list, a group that ranged in age from 101 years old to 113 years old when I interviewed them. So I finally had a big break. I had a list of names to go by, and I started making phone calls. Now, remember, this list was already 5 years old at the time, so upwards of 95% of people on the list had already passed away, which meant that I had quite a few fairly awkward phone calls. If you've ever called a house looking for somebody who's passed away, you know it can be a bit touchy. The first dozen or so phone calls I made were very straightforward. May I speak to so-and-so? No, he's passed away. And then I called a number in Queens, and a woman answered the phone, and I said, may I speak to Mr. So-and-so? And instead of saying he's passed away, she said, what is this regarding? And I got very excited. And I said, my name is Richard Rubin. I'm trying to find living American World War I veterans. I'd like to interview them about their experiences in the war. I understand he served in the war. I must have spoken very fast and blurted it all out. And I said, I understand he served in World War I. I'd love to come interview him. And there was a pause on the line for a minute. And then she said, well, you're barking up the wrong tree. He's dead. And slammed down the receiver. And I was a bit shaken up by this. And I did the thing that your parents always tell you to do when you're a kid. If you fall off the horse, you get right back on again, which was not good advice in this situation. I really should have taken a little more time to compose myself and think about how I was going to ask these questions. So I picked up the phone. I called the next number on the list, and a woman answered the phone, and I said, is this so-and-so's residence? And she said, yes. And I said, is he still around? And she said, no, he passed away 3 years ago, and for future reference, you might just want to ask, is he still living? Which turned out to be very good advice, and I did this about 40 or 50 times, until finally one day I called a number in Orleans, Massachusetts, and which is at the elbow of Cape Cod. A woman answered the phone, and I said, is this the residence of Mr. J. Lawrence Moffat? And she said, it is. And I said, is he still living? And she said, he is. And as I recall, I dropped the phone. I don't know if it really happened or not, but that's how I remember it, and picked it up again. And there was silence on the line there for a minute because I was struck dumb. And finally she said, would you like to speak to him? And I talked to Mr. Moffat and explained who I was and what I was doing. And he said, well, come on up. So made a date to come on up in a couple of weeks. And those 2 weeks were a very anxious time for me. Because before that, the existence of living American World War I veterans had been merely theoretical. So the search was everything. But now I was like the dog who chases the car all the time and finally catches up with it. I had to figure out how to drive the car with no opposable thumbs. And I was very, very anxious, as I said. And that anxiety carried on until I got to Orleans, Massachusetts. It was July 20th. 2003. This is Mr. Moffat here. You can see him on the left, June 1917 at the age of 20, and on the right, November the 11th, 2003 at the age of 106. That's actually the second time I visited him. So I got to his house. It was a little house set back in the woods, and when I got there, you know, I had all this equipment to set up, a video camera and tape recorder. And I noticed that there was really only one usable chair in the house, a big comfortable armchair, which Mr. Moffat immediately offered to me. And I'm a New Yorker, but still I'm polite enough to know that you don't take a chair from a 106-year-old man. So I immediately turned around and offered it back to him. And I sat in the only other usable seat in the house, which is the wheelchair that you see in that photo, and conducted the interview. And I started the interview the way I started every interview. What is your name? Then where were you? When were you born? Where were you born? What were your parents' names? What did your father do for a living? Did your mother work? What did she do? Did you have siblings? I did this to ease into the interview, to make them comfortable, to get warmed up. And this went on for about 15 minutes or so, and things were still, I was still pretty nervous. I thought, how well is this man, this 106-year-old man, going to be able to recall things that he did and saw 85 years ago? I had no idea, and a big part of me thought, this is just ridiculous. This is never going to work. So about 15 minutes into the interview, I asked him where he went to high school. And I'm going to read to you his response, complete and unedited. I went to high school from Lebanon. That's Lebanon, Connecticut, a small town in the eastern part of the state where he grew up. That high school was in Willimantic, which was about 2 miles from home. And then I was directed to an insurance company in Hartford for a position and accepted. And I spent my life in insurance. I was hired by two companies, one then another. And I went to World War I. I graduated from high school in 1914. I went in the Army in 1917, in April of 1917, just before war was declared. And I was in the Army for 2 years, 18 months in France, in the 1st Division to go to France. The division was the 26th Division, made up of the National Guard of the 6 New England states. There are 4 infantry regiments in a division and artillery batteries with which I am not acquainted. And the 101st Infantry Regiment was made up of the Massachusetts National Guard. The 102nd was made up of Connecticut National Guard. That's where I was, in the 102nd Infantry. The 103rd Infantry Regiment was from Maine, and the 104th from New Hampshire and Vermont, and artillery mostly from Rhode Island. Let me remind you, this man is 106 years old. And we were, in Connecticut, we were assembled at New Haven. All the different National Guard companies of Connecticut were assembled in New Haven in 1917, July. And from there, we went, it was so early in the war, there were no transports. We went, my company and I don't know how many others, went by train, the CV, Central Vermont, to Montreal, and then embarked there and sailed down the St. Lawrence to Halifax, where we joined several other National Guard companies that were ready to go across and went across to Liverpool. A 9-day trip it was. And then across the channel to France, and then across France to a certain area, Landeville, and the regiment trained there, trained for 4 months there. And in February, we were sent to the front. At that time, the Allies, Britain and France and Belgium and others, they were, had been in the war since 1914. And we joined them in 1917 and went to the front in February of 1918. So the first sector was the Allies at that time were defending themselves against the attacks of Germany. And we were just in defensive action. I was in the headquarters company of the infantry regiment and on the staff of the colonel along with others. I had the rank of a corporal. And I escaped the front line, trench warfare, but I was subject to constant artillery fire. I spent my 21st birthday in the front line, March 6th of 1918. And I went out on patrol with a patrol group that night. And we spent 2 months in that sector, which was the Chemin de Dames. Well, that was our first sector. 2 months later, we were moved to another sector, the Toul sector. And then came Chateau Thierry in the summer of 1918, and then the closing war at Saint-Mihiel and Verdun. And the war was over, as you know, on November 11th of 1918. And President Wilson paid our company a visit while we were there and talked to us, and that might have, I don't remember, don't recall now just when that was or what the occasion was, but it was maybe a holiday. So that was his answer to the question, where did you go to high school? And I never worried after that whether I had bitten off more than I could chew or whether these men, very old men and women, would be able to recall things that they had seen and done 85, 90 years earlier. Although, as you can see, it wasn't perfect. His memory did fall apart at the end. He couldn't recall the holiday. I don't know how he forgot that. It was Christmas, I later found out through research. And he actually told a very funny story about that. He said that they were lined up at attention for 4 hours waiting for President Wilson, who was late, and they missed their lunch. But eventually they got to eat. And I asked him, did you get to speak to the president? And he said, no, but a buddy of mine did. And I said, what did he say? And he said, the president asked him how conditions were, and his friend answered, lousy. and the friend was apparently reprimanded for that. I want to show you a little bit of a clip here. One thing I should say is that that picture, as I said, was taken actually on November the 11th, 2003, Veterans Day. I went back to see him again for a second time, primarily because he told me that he made a habit of riding in every parade that they put on in this little town of Orleans. And I asked him why, and he said, well, I assume people like to see a World War I exhibit. And he's wearing his original helmet from the war. That little painting on the crown is the Connecticut Charter Oak, the symbol of the 102nd Infantry Regiment. And he got dressed up for the parade, as you can see. I want to show you just a little video clip here of my first interview with Mr. Moffat.
Did you come under artillery fire often?
All the time. We lived under it.
What was that like?
Well, after a while, you disregarded it. You didn't worry about it. You felt if I get it, I get it. If I don't, I don't. And you just paid no attention to the shells dropping around you. You couldn't worry about it all the time. Right.
Did you ever come under gas attack?
All the time. There was gas and all the shells, practically. Yes, I was severely gassed several times, but I never went to medical for it. I just lost my voice, and eventually it would come back.
So you were very lucky.
Yes, I was very.
So whenever that would, when artillery would come in, you would put on your gas mask?
That's right. After a while. Yes, we were trained to put on the gas masks. I guess, as I remember, 6 seconds was the time it would take to put on a gas mask. And when the stealth started coming over, you would use those 6 minutes to get the gas mask on. And after a while, you didn't bother to put the gas mask on. You smelled the gas, and if it wasn't severe, you didn't bother to put the gas mask on. And we lived with that.
I liked him a lot. Anybody who tells you that gas wasn't that bad, he just lost his voice for a few days and eventually it would come back, I think that says an awful lot about what kind of a person he was. I did not make a habit of this. There are people who, in the last few years, when there were just a couple of World War I veterans left, would write to them and ask for an autograph, and they would get an autograph back, and those things turn up on eBay now. I did not make a habit of doing that, but the second time I visited Lawrence Moffett, before that visit, I found this, which is a piece of sheet music, Long Live the 26th. That was his division. And I wanted to show it to him. And after showing it to him on Veterans Day 2003, I asked him if he would sign it for me, and he did. This is his, it says, Jesse Lawrence Moffett, Headquarters Company, 102nd Infantry, 26th Division, AEF. And he wrote AEF over the date, so then he wrote the date again for me, November 11, 2003. And I can promise you this will never turn up on eBay, at least as long as I'm alive. Believe it or not, he did not have the very best memory of among the 36 or so men and women I interviewed. That distinction probably belongs to this gentleman, Sam Goldberg. There he is on the left at 1918, at the age of 18. You can see he was in the cavalry. That's his horse, which did not have a name. The Army did not name cavalry horses. They just gave them numbers. But he liked his horse, so he named him Chickamauga because he said the horse was so old, it had been at the Battle of Chickamauga in 1863. And there he is on the right, May 16, 2006, at the age of 106 in Greenville, Rhode Island, where I interviewed him. When I asked him the first question I asked everybody, what is your name, he said, this is exactly how he said it, Samuel Benedict Goldberg. He had the best diction of anybody I've ever met, and he was 106 years old. He also had the best memory of anybody I've ever met. He could recall the precise date upon which he arrived in America from Poland, December the 27th, 1907. He remembered the name of the ship, the Campania, which he then spelled for me. He could remember every address at which he'd ever lived, the precise dates at which he'd lived at those addresses, every job he'd ever held, the precise dates he'd started and left those jobs, and how much he'd been paid. Another remarkable memory was this gentleman, Art Fiala. There he is in 1918 at the age of 19. He was in the 20th Engineers. And there he is on April 30th, 2005, at the age of 106. That's actually the second time I interviewed him. The first time was in September of 2003. And I want to play a little video clip here that'll just show you what kind of a memory he had.
See, that reminds me of something I didn't tell you last time.
Okay.
And that's, you know, when we were situated in the up in that plateau,
Then I had a little time, and I walked up the mountain farther, and I struck a little town up there. And when I got up on top there, the first thing I noticed, the women had wooden shoes, and they had a stick across their shoulders carrying two pails of milk going across the road there, you know. And like me, it didn't take me long to get acquainted with the people there. And they invited me to in their home to see what they had there. And you know they had their cows in the same room in the house with them. And the cows, it was a partition there. You could go in the kitchen, sit there and talk, and hear the cow, dogs mooing and stuff. And, you know, that's the way they live. Oh, I tell you, it's so much different. And there was a guy that used to come up, what they had luggage for, you know, for. He would come up there with a double face wagon of some kind. And you know that man would come up there in the morning and go back in the evening with one log. Yes, sir, that's all they had. They had a wagon in two parts. Uh-huh. The morning they got their log on that. But just think of it. They work all day for it. And they didn't have a circle saw either. They had a little mill with.
So he'd work all day just to bring back one log?
Yeah.
Huh.
Well, most everything was oxen.
Uh-huh.
They had oxen. I saw one place where I saw a horse.
Uh-huh.
That's all.
So, and this was up in the mountains? Or up in the hills, is that right? Did you speak any French?
No.
So how did you get along with the French people in this village?
The first time we went into a restaurant, we didn't know what the hell was asked for. We started crowing like a chicken. Taking life. And then finally they'd know that we were on the edge. That's the way it was.
You just sit down at a restaurant and start crowing like a chicken and a bitch.
Yeah.
But what if they brought you chicken instead?
Well, that'd been all right too.
Isn't he great? By the way, if you want to see more of these videos, pick up one of these cards. It has my website on the back, thelastofthedoughboys.com. And there are video clips up there. There will be more posted in the weeks and months to come. You can also email me through the website, and I hope you will. The reason I showed this clip is because of what he says at the very beginning. He says, "That reminds me of something I didn't tell you last time." So last time was 19 months earlier, and he'd been very sick with pneumonia at the time. I didn't think he was going to make it, to tell you the truth. And you can see he still wears oxygen here. He didn't need it at this point. His son Carl, who you hear in the video, told me that his father didn't need the oxygen anymore, but that he liked it. So they let him keep it. But he said, "That reminds me of something I didn't tell you last time." And then he told me a story that he really hadn't told me last time. And I don't know about you, but I'm 6 decades younger than he was at that point. And ask anybody who knows me, I tell the same story again and again and again without realizing it. So these very old men and women, to my relief, remembered World War I very, very well. What's sadly ironic is that the rest of us have largely forgotten it. And that seems like a strange thing to say in a room full of people at the World War I Historical Association, but it really is true. One of the best examples I can give you is this. You've heard of the book Company K, wonderful World War I novel, first published in 1933, a huge bestseller. This is an edition that was published in 1952. Now, what's wrong with this picture? These don't look like any doughboys I've ever seen. This was, you know, less than 20 years after this book was published, and less than 35 years after the war ended. And this is how thoroughly we had already forgotten World War I in this country. The ironic thing is that it didn't start out that way. World War I, once upon a time in this country, an awful lot of people felt it was tremendously important that we remember that war and the men and women who fought it. The reason I know this is because to this day, I believe there are more monuments and memorials out there in this country to World War I than to any other war. Any town you go to, I'd put money down that there's a World War I monument there, even if there's nothing to the Civil War or World War II or any other conflict. And some of them are really quite elaborate. The first thing you see when you cross over the bridge from Portsmouth, New Hampshire to Kittery, Maine is this. This is a monument to World War I. There's a close-up here, the state of Maine to her sailors and soldiers. And that little inscription there, if you can read it, it actually says, "Lest we forget twice." It's really quite impressive, very large, a lot going on. Here's a close-up in one little nook of the monument. Here's another one. I don't know how well you can see this. It's a bunch of soldiers marching through a trench, not historically accurate. The trench is perfectly straight. I don't want to be one of those people who point stuff like that out, but I guess I am. This is a beautiful little memorial, World War I arch in the small town of Waterville, Maine. And it's so overlooked, so many people pass by it every day without stopping to even look at it, that somebody felt the need to put this up, a sign telling you that this is a World War I arch. And actually on the other side of this little park where the arch is, there's a big brown traffic sign that says World War I Memorial and an arrow pointing at it. And still almost nobody notices it. I lived in Memphis for a few years in the early 1990s. And Overton Park, the largest, oldest park in the city, is dominated by this statue here of a doughboy charging up a hill. This is in a city that was occupied by the Yankees for the last 3 years of the Civil War. This is the most impressive war monument in the entire city. This is the plaque listing the names of everybody from Shelby County who was killed in the war. As you can see, quite a lot of people. One day, I can't remember exactly when, but it was maybe 7 or 8 years ago, I was heading into the Lord & Taylor department store on Fifth Avenue at 39th Street, and I saw this tucked in behind one of the revolving doors in such a weird spot that you actually can't stand in front of it. You have to sort of stand to the side like I was when I took this picture. This is a plaque listing the names of employees of Lord & Taylor who served in World War I, and there are actually two of these. They're both tucked behind these revolving doors at a place that you can't really get to them, but Lord & Taylor thought it was important enough once upon a time to commemorate the service of their employees that they put this up in the department store. There's nothing else to any other war in this entire store. And this thing, unfortunately, is in such a place that almost nobody notices it anymore. But there's stuff like this everywhere you look. This is the World War I Memorial in my hometown, Harrison, New York, in Westchester County. Behind it is the playground that I often played in, and that brick edifice in the back is the public library. This is really the first World War I memorial I ever recall seeing, and I discovered only fairly recently that this is a statue that exists in about 150 or so places around the country. It's called the Spirit of the American Doughboy. And in the book, I describe it as a particularly ugly World War I statue. Please forgive me if you have one in your town and you're very fond of it. I don't think it's particularly artfully rendered. For one thing, the guy, he seems to be walking. He's holding up a grenade. And the look on his face, he looks more confused than anything else. Like he's saying, Captain, what am I supposed to do with this thing again? As I said, there are about 150 of these in towns all around the country. And my hometown is a pretty small place. For it to have a monument of this size, again, no statue to any other war, even though my town was the site of a battle in the Revolutionary War, there's nothing else like it in town. And of course, there's our beautiful and very dignified National World War I Memorial in Washington, D.C. Oh, wait a minute. There is no such thing, as you no doubt know. I actually recently was reminded of this bitter fact when the government shut down and the World War II veterans showed up at the World War II Memorial and insisted on being let in. this got a lot of attention. It just, all it did was remind me that there is no national World War I memorial in Washington, D.C., for which I don't think there's any conceivable excuse. But I will say, I did at least get a laugh out of this situation when the next day on a satirical website, I saw this fake news headline. I got a big kick out of that. So the federal government has not constructed any World War I memorials or monuments on American soil. Interesting thing, though, they've constructed quite a few very impressive World War I memorials on French soil. This is the one at Chateau Thierry. It's enormous, and it really dominates the entire city. It's up on the heights. Anywhere you go in Chateau Thierry, you can't help but see this thing. And really, the picture doesn't do it justice. This is the one at Mont Sec, near part of the old San Miguel salient. This is what it looks like from a distance. And this is what it looks like up close. Absolutely beautiful. Interesting thing about this, it was actually damaged during fighting in World War II and has since been repaired, but there are plaques on it denoting the damage. Without a doubt, certainly the most impressive memorial to World War I, American memorial to World War I in France, is the Meuse-Argonne Cemetery. I'm sure some people in here have been there. I've never seen anything like it. It houses the remains of some 14,000 Americans killed in the last great battle of the war. And it's, in my opinion, the most perfect public green space I've ever seen in my life. Anybody who believes that the federal government can't do anything right needs to go to this cemetery and see it. There's nothing else out there like it. Those are just some of the federal memorials, but of course Americans created a great number of memorials to American service in France. A lot of divisions, in fact most divisions that fought there, have memorials. This is the 77th Division Memorial in the Argonne Forest, near where the Lost Battalion was caught. It's pretty small, as you can see. This is the 28th Division's Memorial in the town of Varennes, also part of the Meuse-Argonne battlefield. It's so big that I couldn't capture the whole thing in a single photograph. The 28th was Pennsylvania National Guard, and they lost a lot of men in the war, especially at Meuse-Argonne. It really is something. By the way, that's an eternal flame in the middle, which was not lit when I saw it, so I guess it's only partially eternal. And as impressive as this memorial is, it hasn't been kept up for a while. I'm not sure why that is. But it's still really grand to behold. This is the Temple Memorial Church in Chateau Thierry, which was built with private American donations after the war. And it's really impressive. There's a Bible in there that was donated by Teddy Roosevelt's widow. And pews and bells and everything in the church was donated by somebody or other. There's an enormous stained glass window in there of General Pershing on a dock in France being greeted by the Marquis de Lafayette, which I'm not sure actually happened. But it's really beautiful to behold. The French, of course, have plenty of monuments of their own in France everywhere you look. Nothing in France will make an impression on you like this. This is the Douaumont Ossuary at Verdun. And this building, which is very, very large, contains the bones of 130,000 French and German soldiers killed in 10 months at Verdun in 1916. I've never seen anything like it. And in fact, the remains are not really showcased. The main part of the building that you can see there, part of it is for displays, and part of it is actually a chapel where they hold Catholic Mass several times a day. But on the outside, has anybody been to the Douaumont Ossuary? Okay, so did you go up and see the windows that are about knee height on the outside? You can walk up to them and peer through them, and You see bones, they're sorted actually by the type of bone they are, I believe. So one chamber is just full of femurs, one is full of skulls. And you look at these things and you think, really, only 130,000? Because that seems a little low after you've looked at the bones. This thing is so massive that it dwarfs this. This is the French cemetery at Verdun, which contains more than 16,000 graves. It's an enormous cemetery, and yet it looks tiny next to the Douaumont ossuary. These are just the official memorials. Everywhere you go in France, there are unofficial memorials to World War I, not by design, but just because after the war, the French didn't have the means or the manpower to clean things up. And so in certain parts of France, every patch of woods that you walk into is filled with trenches like these. These are French trenches. And this is a German trench. The Germans brought a distinctive technological advantage to the war in that much of what they built, trench works and bunkers and things of that nature, they built with concrete because they intended to hold what they had taken. The French and British were not allowed to do this because building things with concrete implied permanence. And that meant that you weren't constantly pushing to drive the invader out of your country. And so, ironically, German trench works have held up much better in the century since the war ended than French trench works, although, as you could see in that previous picture, French trench works are still in very, very good condition. And those there were still about 8 feet deep. This is the Lochnagar mine, the result of an explosion, an underground explosion that the British set off on July the 1st, 1916, the first morning of the Battle of the Somme. And if you want some scale, that little teeny tiny thing up at the top is a human being. And this is actually quite a popular tourist attraction in France. But I came across craters of a similar size in the Argonne Forest that weren't even marked. They were just there among the trees, and if you weren't careful, you were going to roll down into one and have a real hard time getting back out. This is a French bunker in the Argonne Forest. The family of a lieutenant named de Corson later turned this into a memorial to their son. It says, "The bunker of Lieutenant de Corson, who died gloriously in 1915. This is a German dugout in the Argonne Forest. These things are so common that they don't really even attract attention. They're certainly not closed off. There are no signs to them. They're pretty much everywhere you look. This one is a particular favorite of mine. This is also in the Argonne Forest. This is the bunker that belonged to Crown Prince Wilhelm, the oldest son of Kaiser Wilhelm II, who was the commander of a German army that was in the Argonne for much of the war. And it really looks much more like a posh chateau than a bunker. Inside, it had two fireplaces that were originally covered with marble. And the marble has long ago been carried off by souvenir hunters who, in its place, have left a lot of graffiti. Again, this is not blocked off. There's no sign. This is just the kind of thing that you stumble upon while hiking in French woods, which, by the way, if you go out and do this, wear pants and socks, because French woods are filled with Lyme disease-carrying ticks. I found this out the hard way. I don't have Lyme disease, thankfully, but it's not just an American phenomenon. And it's not just these kinds of things that are still out there reminding us a century later that this tremendous war was fought on French soil. This is a case of artifacts in a little makeshift museum belonging to a gentleman named Gilles Lejeune. This is in the small town of Maligny-en-Auxois, which is near Belleau Wood. And these are things that Gilles Lejeune, who's in his mid-40s, has just accumulated over the course of his life, just poking around. You can see a helmet there and a boot. This is all American stuff, a tobacco tin, rations tins, a shaving kit. There's an identification disc at about 8 o'clock on the margin there. All of this stuff are things that he's found over the course of a few decades of just poking around. And in fact, his little museum is extremely popular with former Marines, retired Marines, who every year hundreds of them make a pilgrimage to Belleau Wood. This is a museum belonging to a gentleman named Jean-Paul DeVries in the town of Romaine, the same town that the Meuse-Argonne Cemetery is in. Maybe some people in this room have actually been to this museum. And Mr. DeVries is, has anybody here met Mr. DeVries? He's a really interesting character. He's a little man with an endless curiosity about World War I. He takes people out all the time looking for stuff. When there aren't people to take out, he just goes out on his own looking around stuff. Everything in this museum, these are all things that he found, not only that he found, but that he found sitting on the surface of the earth, not even buried. Since the 1970s, it's been illegal to use metal detectors in France to scavenge for World War I artifacts. And so everything he has here actually was found just sitting on the surface of the earth, plowed up that very day or in a forest that had never been plowed in the first place. And when he told me that, I guess I looked a little dubious because he said, come on, I'll show you. And he took me out and we stopped in a patch of woods that once upon a time had been a German rest camp and later was part of the Meuse-Argonne battlefield. And we were walking through these woods and he found a German bottle and some German barbed wire and some rusted caps for mortars. And then he saw an old tree that had been felled in a storm recently. He got very excited and he ran over to this tree and he beckoned for me to follow. And there in the roots of this tree, the massive clump of roots of this recently felled tree, were dozens and dozens of bullets. And he told me that the tree drew them out of the soil along with water. And that when these trees were felled, these bullets would be revealed to the world. It was really something. And then he took me to a little field, maybe about 2 acres, a farm field that had just been plowed that morning. And we walked through it, and in about 5 minutes, I saw this clump of 5 perfect bullets. And about the length of the first section of my thumb with a very, very sharp point. And I took them and a bunch of other stuff I found in the field that morning. There was a piece of a pineapple grenade and a comb and cartridges and a button from a Bavarian tunic. And I mailed it all home to myself. And years later, I took the bullets into a gun shop in Augusta, Maine, trying to get a referral to somebody who might be able to tell me what they were. And the gentleman who owned this shop got very, very excited when he saw these bullets. It was like it was Christmas morning. And he held one up. He looked at it for a minute. He said, yeah, this is an 8mm. Came from a German Mauser Gewehr 98 rifle. He said, it wouldn't make a big hole, but it would go through you and the guy behind you and the guy behind him. Which really drove the point home. I didn't even mean that. I'm sorry. Can we edit that out before this goes up on YouTube? I said drove, I didn't say fired the point home. As we were about to leave that field, I looked down and I saw this. This is an unexploded shell. And a little smaller than my foot. And if you saw something like this, being smart, you probably would slowly back off. But my first impulse was to bend over and pick it up, which Monsieur DeVries used every ounce of his strength to keep me from doing and probably saved my life because he told me every year people are killed or maimed by unexploded World War I ordnance. And just a few weeks ago, I was talking in a public library in Jackson, New Hampshire, and there was a gentleman in the audience there, and when I showed this slide, he said that he could tell by the rings that there was gas in this shell. And so if I hadn't been restrained by Monsieur DeVries, I might have been blown up and gassed nearly a century after the armistice. Stuff like this pops up every time fields are plowed in certain parts of France. And experts say that it's going to keep popping up for the next 200 or 300 years. That's how much of it was dropped there. You can go scoop it up for yourself, or you can go to a place like this. This is a little trailer that was parked outside that enormous crater I showed you a few minutes ago, selling World War I relics as souvenirs. And there's no shortage of places like that in France, too. So really, all of France, in a way, is a memorial to World War I. But there was a program that the country instituted at the end of the war, wherein they gave money to every settlement in the country, no matter how small, to erect a memorial to World War I. And I'm told that in the entire country, only 5 settlements did not build one. In the entire country. This is a pretty typical one here. This is in the little village of Richecourt, which is part of the San Miguel Salient. And Richecourt only lost about a dozen denizens in the war, but this is a pretty large and impressive memorial, and it's not unusual in that regard. But what I found most gratifying to behold was that in certain parts of France, like the San Miguel Salient, which was liberated by Americans in September of 1918, a lot of towns chose to build memorials not just to the French, but to the Americans. For instance, the village of Fleury built 2 memorials, and this is the American memorial in Fleury. There are a couple of doughboys there, and it says, from Lorraine to the United States, 12 September 1918, which was the first day of the Battle of San Miguel. And in fact, quite a few American troops pushed off from Fleury. Perhaps the most moving thing that I saw there in this regard was this. This is the only World War I monument in the town of Thiaucourt, France, also part of the San Miguel Salient. And it happens to be the same village where the San Miguel American Cemetery is located today. This is their statue, and as you can see, on the right there is a poilu shaking hands with a doughboy on the left. And unlike America, France, of course, has not forgotten World War I. But what would surprise a great many Americans is that they still appreciate what Americans did in World War I. This is not a statue that nobody pays attention to. Everybody in the area knows about the existence of this statue, and they know what it signifies. And believe it or not, as an American in this part of France, I was treated exceedingly well because of these shared memories that go back nearly a century, so far that nobody living there actually has firsthand knowledge of the events anymore. But to them, the First World War is still very much alive, in part because of these monuments, in part because of things like the Douaumont Ossuary, in part because of trenches that still litter the woods and patches of woods that are still covered with shell holes, and in part because of the things that come up out of the surface of the earth every time fields are plowed there. Now, of course, World War I was not actually fought on American soil, but artifacts like that continue to pop up here every day also, just in a different fashion. Rather than in a field, they turn up in attics or basements or photo albums. And this is the thing I want to leave you with today, is that Americans at this point have largely forgotten the First World War. It's a sad thing to say, and none of us like it, but it is true. But the centennial of the war starts next year, and there's a real opportunity for us to reclaim our memories of the war and our role in the war. And that starts with everybody in this room. Maybe everybody here is already aware of those artifacts that exist for yourself, but maybe there are more out there. Maybe there's a book in your attic right now that nobody's opened for 60 years, and if you go flip through it, you'll find folded up in its pages a yellowed letter that somebody sent home from the front in 1918. Maybe there's a box of knickknacks, and in there is an identification disc. Maybe you'll be flipping through a photo album one day, and you'll come across something like this. This is a photo taken at Camp Upton in the fall of 1917, of the 306th Field Artillery Battery C, part of the 77th Division, which was composed entirely of draftees from the city of New York. And this photo album belongs to my father, and somewhere in that photo is my grandfather, Corporal Abraham Rubin. There are things like this out there in all of our attics, in all of our photo albums. And I think it's incumbent upon us to remind people that World War I was our war too. It wasn't just people wearing kilts kicking soccer balls as they went over the top to the sounds of bagpipes. It was our war too, and we played a tremendous role in it. We paid a huge price for it, nearly 117,000 American lives over the course of just 19 months. And this is a very important part of our history too. It was a very important part of making us who we are today. And so I hope as the centennial develops, perhaps interest in that period of our history will will blossom also. I did the best I could. I tracked down the last living American veterans, as many as I could, and interviewed them. Unfortunately, they're all gone now, but there's still a lot of history out there for us to reclaim, and I hope we'll do it. I know everybody in this room will certainly do their part. So I thank you all for coming. I'm happy to take questions if anybody has any. Yes, sir. Did I talk to Frank Buckles? Yes, I interviewed Frank Buckles about 7 or 8 times. He was one of the first veterans I interviewed. Frank Buckles, for those of you who may not know, was the, which is probably nobody in this room, was the last living American veteran of World War I. He died February the 27th, 2011, at the age of 110 years and 27 days, to be precise. Yeah, I sounded like Sam Goldberg there. I first interviewed him on August 30th, 2003, and the last time I interviewed him in person was, I believe, March 20th, 2008. It was in March of 2008. But I spoke to him on the phone a few times after that, too. So I interviewed him in all about 8 times. Yeah, he was a remarkable human being. He, in case you don't know, did not see frontline service. He did all he could to make it to France in the war. He was just 16 when he enlisted, lied about his age. And that's how he described it to me the first few times I interviewed him. And then as he became the last living American veteran and got a little more attention, he decided to say he fudged his age rather than lied about it. I guess he decided he didn't like the verb lied. He was taken prisoner as a civilian by the Japanese in World War II and was held for 39 months and developed beriberi, which is a neurological disorder as a result of malnutrition. And for the rest of his life, he had balance issues. When I would walk with him, I would have to keep a hand pressed into the small of his back. So he could maintain his balance. But he was really a remarkable man. He has his own chapter in the book. So, yeah, thanks. Yes, sir.
In respect to French monuments, I noticed in my slight time in France that in many of the small-town churches, there would be plaques in the church commemorating the veterans that died in the war. And some also had civilians in that town who were killed as a result of the fighting.
That's right, yes. Not just in churches, but also on the town's monuments. It was up to the town who they wanted to commemorate. And in fact, in some of these towns, the World War I monument also became the World War II monument, and people would graft onto this monument a separate plaque commemorating people who had died a victime de la barbarie nazi. And often they were civilians. Yeah, so very interesting to me to go around these parts of France and see almost nothing mentioning World War II at all. So, yes, sir.
Just one comment, somewhat trivial, but when you showed the picture of the cavalry and the horse who didn't have a name but had a number,
uh-huh.
It just reminded me that when I was stationed in 1968, I was stationed in Fort Riley, Kansas. And that is a cavalry base.
Uh-huh.
And of course, in 68, it became the air cavalry, helicopters, rather than horses. However, there must have been horses in World War II, because while I was stationed there, the last living horse died.
Huh.
And he was named Chief.
Huh.
Now, I that irrelevant, but he had a funeral that would have put a general to shame.
Huh. Yeah, I guess maybe as it got later on and there were fewer horses, they reverted to naming them. But it's, you know, it's interesting that you bring up World War II, because I get emails from people sometimes saying, please tell me you're going to do this for World War II veterans too. And I always respond, you don't need me to do this for World War II veterans. There'll be plenty of people to do this. You know, I'm not a historian. I'm certainly not a military historian. And the truth is that I wrote this. I wouldn't have written this book if somebody else had done it. I wrote this book because I wanted to read this book. And I kept waiting for somebody else to write it. And at a certain point, it became apparent that nobody else did. And that, to me, is to this day remains as mystifying as the fact that the VA didn't have records of living American World War I veterans. I don't know how to explain it, but certainly that will not be the case with the World War II generation. So I'm gathering from Paul's lurking presence that it's time to move on, but I'll be here. I'll be happy to sign your books. Everybody, please, whether you have a book or not, make sure you take one of these. It's got the website on the back. You can contact me through the website. I'd love to hear from you, and I hope you all stay in touch. I thank you for coming.
There's the anchor coming, the anchor coming, the drum, drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer, send the word to beware. We'll be older, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there. Johnny, get your gun, get your gun, get your gun. Johnny, show the hug, you're a son of a gun. Hoist the flag and let her fly.